We are American children. We are a unique people group because none of us will stay children, but there will always be children in the world. Throughout history, adults keep changing things and disagreeing on what to do with us, generation by generation. In colonial New England, we were considered blessings. We were raised with many siblings and helped cook, clean, and clear land. Our parents built schoolhouses and made sure that we were taught how to read the Bible. As the colonies flourished, our schooling included Latin and Greek. We memorized everything, and if we misbehaved, we were disciplined. But some of us came over from Africa. Our families were broken up, and for many years we were not allowed to learn to read. Republican ideals were all the rage after the Revolutionary War. Adults did their best to instill in us virtues such as responsibility and respect so that we would become upstanding citizens. Then, with the 1800s, came another revolution, this time industrial. We started working in factories, some of us younger than 10 years old. We had to work long hours in dangerous conditions. Many of us were immigrant children from Ireland who had to help provide for our families. For those of us who did not have to work, our family size shrank. Our parents lavished extra attention on us. Europeans thought we were brats, but our parents believed they were raising us to be independent individuals. Our families were mini republics. To prepare us to be good citizens, adults started supporting public schools with taxes. Even though we only attended these schools for a few months out of the year, we did learn the three R's at least. Then Horace Mann came along to modernize our educational system. Noah Webster and William McGuffey also wrote some reading lessons that encouraged us to be patriotic and moral. After the Civil War, female teachers came down from the North to educate those of us who had been former slaves, reinforcing the connection between education and citizenship. Although the rise of compulsory grade school education helped to keep us from overworking, the Gilded Age was not the best time for those of us in factories. But in 1893, women led by Florence Kelly lobbied for the prohibition of child labor with the Illinois Factory Inspection Act. Also, these women started settlement homes such as Hull House, where they helped immigrant children learn English. Urbanization put stress on our families. We became simply mouths to feed and bodies that took up space in filthy tenements, so our families became smaller. In the early 1900s, the National Child Labor Committee with photographer Lewis Hine exposed our depressing factory conditions. People began to want to help us, especially women who campaigned to keep us out of sweatshops and mills. In 1916, President Wilson signed the Keating-Owen Act that kept us from working more than 8 hours a day if we were under 16. Yet the Supreme Court ruled this unconstitutional. Then came World War I and another surge of patriotism. We were encouraged to raise money for the war effort and eat every last scrap of our vegetables. We knitted washcloths and wrote letters to our soldiers. Our teachers stressed virtues and nationalism, echoing the president's moral diplomacy. In the 1920s, a tremendous debate flurried up between Darwinians and fundamentalists over evolution and whether it should be taught to us. The fundamentalists fought for the truth of creation, while Darwinists argued that their ideas were more rational. Adults were debating not only what we were being taught, but how we were being taught. Professor John Dewey introduced progressive education, emphasizing learning by doing. People opposed that, too, because it took away the traditional classical model. This provided the basis for the later homeschooling movement. The Great Depression gave us the Fair Labor Standards Act of 1938. Finally, nobody could make us work before we turned 16. Our patriotism continued during World War II, when we collected scrap metal, grew victory gardens, and knitted socks. The government also set up 3,000 temporary daycare centers so that our mothers could help in the workforce. After the war ended, a baby boom resulted in so many of us that some started to worry. Following Brown v. Board of Education, adults started integrating our schools, hoping to give black and white children an equal education. Some of our parents were angry about it. That was a messy time for us. We were bussed all over the place, sometimes kept home from school. On some occasions, soldiers had to come escort us black children to our classes. In 1973, a ground-shaking court decision, Roe v. Wade, legalized abortion. We were no longer priceless gifts from God, we were lumps of matter. Because of this, the religious right arose during the 1980s, fighting for our unborn lives. As the years chugged along into the new century, nuclear families began deteriorating as divorce rates soared. Our families were fragmented and our parents separated. Oftentimes, we were entrusted to parent substitutes like daycare and television. However, more of us are graduating and launching ourselves into a world interconnected by technology. So you see that adults have argued about us for centuries, how we should be taught, what we should be taught, how much we should work, and whether we are even considered human before we are born. It's very strange, don't you think, that even though they all used to be children themselves, they still can't agree.